Let's pray. Father in heaven, you know about what's going to take place before it ever happens. And I ask, Lord, that this time that is sanctified for you be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, we're singing about that glorious future. And our focus, when we got thinking about heaven, it's a good thing, isn't it? But we're still here. Now, I don't say that as a negative thing, but I want to make a point here. So I have got some volunteers. Emily, would you come right on up here? You know, and Murph, would you come up? I know, look at that head. He's trying to hide his head. You know, as big as he is, he can't hide. Stand up. You know, come on up here. Yeah, you can do it. You know, you're only visitors here once. The second time you come, we draft you and make you regulars. All right. Diane, you get right up there with him. Get right there with him. We got one on that side. On that, you stand there. You don't stand alone. Okay. Let's see. Let's get Kimberly. Come on up here. Get over here. We're going to find out something here. Let's see. Logan, they need you up here. Would you please? No, you won't go up there. You're a bad dude. All right. Who else can I draft here? You want to be drafted? Okay, Sammy, go stand here. I need five volunteers from over here. Let's see. Who can I get? Mo, you're going to volunteer. Pete, you come on up here. You can do it. Yep, you can do it. Let's see here. Who else would like? Bruce, you can do that. We got one, two. Diane, you love this stuff. I know you do. All right. And Donna, come on in here. Okay. Now, I want you to come over here. Over here. You line up over here. We're going to have a little contest here. You got one, two, three. You guys over there on that side, your team, make room for each other. He doesn't bite. You move over that way. Move over that way. All right. There you go. All right. And come over here and line up. It's okay. It's okay. We want to be seen. That way, we're going to put you on TV, make real celebrities out of you. All right. Now, what's the name of this game?
Jenga Gong,
whatever it is. All right. Okay. You know how this is played? Everybody know? Okay, I think the object is you're supposed to take a block out without it all collapsing. And the team that wins. So you don't when you pull out a block, and then they pull out a block, and you keep rotating until we have a winner. Okay. Oh, you're not going to put them back on top. No, once they're gone, they're gone. They're supposed to do all kinds of... Okay, put it on top. I don't know how to play it because I hate tearing things up. You build it up. Okay, we're going to do this quickly. I'm going to give you about a 5-second time limit. How's that? All right, you start. Go ahead, start. Can we get somebody to play music for him? Like, all right, dear, one of you go up there and just play some background music to get some real tension, like, bum, 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 bum. Okay.
Oh, no, but only.
I don't get any volunteers over there, huh? All right, just take one. There you go. Oh, look at that man go. Okay. All right. Now it's your turn. All right. You know everything. You can do it now. Okay. All right. We'll see how long this thing lasts. Wow. This game could be over quickly. Wow. Look at that. She is some good.
My wife told me not to come up here.
The engineer at work. You believe that? I don't believe that. All right. All right, last shot. Come on, there. I'm going to have to conclude. All right. Very good. All right, that's one of the longest introductions. That's good. Nah, that's fine. All right. Now, there's a point to all of that, believe it or not. All right. The concept here is that, like with the game, you got all of these building blocks here. But you know, with all the building blocks we have, eventually, if you keep peeling away a block, eventually it's going to fall. And believe it or not, the foundation for which these blocks were placed was upon the Scripture. And what we see today going across our land is that the building blocks of our nation are gradually being peeled away. And the other day, we were in prayer meeting, and Greg said this. He said something about that. You notice in the book of Judges and Israel that when they bounce, they come back, but they never came back to the height that they were before. They started here, then they fall, then they come back to here and back to here. And we look around here in our nation, and we're finding that in our nation, the foundational blocks are being peeled away piece by piece, a little here, a little there, and our nation is not the nation that it once was. And we see the effects of this going on recently in Baltimore. We just saw that. It's on the news. You see the rioting. You see the looting. You see all the things that are going on. And there was a black pastor. I happened to come home just the time, turned on the TV, and I happened to see this black pastor, and he was standing up. He lives there. And he basically said, in just a short time that I listened to him, he said, what we need, and he's speaking about that community, but he could have said it anywhere. He said, what we need to come back to our families. We need to come back to faith. We need to come back to our churches. What he was saying was, we need revival. We need revival. And what we see is a manifestation of the building blocks are constantly being under-eroded here in our nation and across our land. And I presume that everybody here knows and understands that Christianity itself is under attack and being persecuted around the world in a fashion that I don't think has ever been recorded throughout all of history. And in fact, I happened to hear just a little bit on the Glenn Beck program. He got an email or a message from a pastor in Iraq. And the pastor in Iraq, he had 5 children. And he said, pray for us. Because ISIS is now in town. The next email he got from him says, pray for us. ISIS has now come to our church and come to our doors and told us that they're going to come back and that we had to submit and convert and become Muslims and they would be back. And then his email, he said, will God forgive us if I have my children to convert to become Muslims? In order to save their lives. Shortly thereafter, they came back. And they confronted the boys, the kids, and they said, will you convert to become Muslims? And they said, no, never. We believe in Jesus. We will never convert. And they restrained the father and executed the children before his very eyes. That's one story. We could say this 1,000 times over. And in fact, I just heard this morning, just for a little bit, that it happened again in Iraq, and it happened again. And we hear it over and over. So Christianity is certainly under attack. And in the book of Hebrews, I thought about this portion of Scripture that it talks about the Christians and the persecution and the things that are going on. In the book of Hebrews, in chapter 11, the Scripture described this way. He said, and others had trial of cruel mockings and scourging, yes, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sewn asunder, they were tested, they were slain with the sword, they wandered about in sheepskin and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, and tormented. That sounds familiar. It's going on now. He says, of whom the world was not worthy, they wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And all these things, having received witness through faith, received not the promise. It goes on and gives some other things. And so we see here that these are the events that have happened. Now, I think about this and the question that was asked of believers of Jesus one time when the Tower of Siloam had come down and 18 people were killed. And they said, are these people that died, are they more evil than others? And that's why this has happened to them. And Jesus' answer to them was, no. In no way. They were no different, no worse than others. But he said this. Basically, he summed it up. He said, accidents are going to happen. We live in a world of sin. Two, you need to be ready. Three, eternity is at stake. No, they're not better, they're not worse, but they are believers, but the world wasn't worthy of these individuals who have suffered. And so Christianity is certainly under attack around the world. We see the refugees leaving, flying, and coming to places such as Portland. They're here. But you know what? Christianity is under attack in the United States of America and the state of Maine. It's here. You've seen it. You've heard it. A bakery fined $131,000 because they stood for traditional marriage. We see at MIT, they said Chick-fil-A cannot do business here. Why? Because they stood for traditional marriage and took a stand that this is what we believe. And because they oppose same-sex marriage, they have been blackballed and said, you cannot do business because of that. We're here in America. Just last weekend, Dr. Deborah Owens, she's a leader of the Coalition of African American Pastors. And while she was up on the platform in Russellville, Arkansas, she was interrupted in her address while the LGBT activist with protest signs and rainbow flags ran up on the stage with her, attempting to disrupt the event. And you see that across our college institutions when somebody comes and stands and has a traditional conservative values and wants to speak in a university setting. They try to protest. They shut them down. They say, you cannot speak here. They try to silence them. Dr. Owens went on to say, we the people are being silenced, intimidated, bullied, and are in danger of persecution for believing in God's design for a marriage. On Face the Nation last week, Bob Schieffer, his first comment to Tony Perkins, who is the leader of the Family Research Council, which was a springoff of Focus on the Family, this is the first thing he says to him. He says, Mr. Perkins, I'm going to say this to you up front. You and your group have been so strong in coming out against gay marriage that the Southern Poverty Law Center has branded the Freedom Research Council as an anti-gay hate group. We have been inundated by people who say that you should not appear because in their view, they say that you don't speak for Christians. That's the first thing he says. The goal of the LGBT activists is to silence the voice of Christians so that the effects of those speaking to redefine marriage and undermine religious freedom go unchallenged in the media. That is the goal. In the book of Hosea in chapter 4 and verse 6, probably one of the most familiar portions of Scripture in the book of Hosea. And in that text in Hosea, God is addressing the people of Israel because this issue of marriage. And he likens the issue of Israel with marriage to himself. And you know the story about Hosea and his wife and the thing going. So he's addressing that issue. And what does he say? He says in that text, he says, God's people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. God's people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. In the book of Proverbs in chapter 29 and verse 18, it says that without a vision, the people perish. And that word without a vision means without a revelation from God, the people will perish. And because of a lack of knowledge, they would suffer the consequences. In the book of Ephesians in chapter 5, it says it something like this. Wherefore, he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And so basically he says, wake up. That's what he says. Wake up. Wake up. Therefore, the first thing that we need to do in our land, the first thing that we need to do, we need to be aware of what's going on. We need to be aware of what's going on. We cannot afford to sleep. The enemy's not going to. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. It says, and the children of Issachar were men who had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. They were people who understood the times and knew what they ought to do. And we need to know what to do too. One, we need to become aware of what is going on in our nation. We need to become aware of what's going on around us. And the second thing is we need to become the advocates of God's biblical institution. Advocates for God's biblical institution and the institution of marriage. In the book of Genesis, and many of you are familiar with this, in the book of Genesis in chapter 2, verse 18, God said it was not good that man should be alone. So God would make him a helpmeet, somebody appropriate fit for him. And then he goes on in verse 21, and he says, and Lord God caused a sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up his flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And so we find here that God instituted the institution of marriage. Before government, there was marriage. Before children, there was what? Marriage. God's divine order. Marriage, then children. That institution was established first. Government came later. The first institution was the institution of marriage. God's divine order. And then we find in the New Testament that Jesus came along in John chapter 2, and you'll read the text about the wedding at Cana of Galilee. The first miracle that Jesus performed was at a wedding, and the wedding was with a man and a woman, and he blessed the institution of marriage. And then we find, if you go on to Ephesians in chapter 5, you'll find out that Jesus Christ pictures the relationship of Christ with his bride, the church. You get the picture of the groom, male, and the bride is female. And we see that picture in the scripture. Jesus then, because sin is what it is, and things get all messed up, in Matthew chapter 19, verse 4 through 6, we find that Jesus defended this institution of marriage. When they came to test him on the institution of marriage, and as they were testing him, then he reverted back to from the beginning. He said, from the beginning, God brought together one man and one woman and put them together, and it was to be until death do them part. Matthew chapter 19, verse 4 through 6. Read it for yourself. But you'll find that Jesus defended the institution of marriage. Today, many are not aware, but that there is a call across the land for churches today to stand up and to preach in defense of marriage. Who would have ever thought you'd have to stand up and preach to defend the institution of marriage? But that's where we are today. Historically, marriage from the time of creation to the past few years has always been recognized of a man and a woman. Historically, going back to the creation, going back 100 years ago, going back 50 years ago, it has never throughout history been anything other than a man and a woman. That's what God had ordained. Now, when you stand up to try to tell people that and defend that, some people get a little bit ugly. And Jonathan told me the other day that as he's had some discussion with some people, it gets heated really quick. If you want something to really get heated, this issue is going to get things heated. And so he began to talk about it, so he defended it biblically, and then he turned, and the people got ugly with that, and then he turned on them and he said, well, here, you show me in the Bible where it teaches the same-sex marriage is ordained of God. Well, then they got mad because they couldn't do that. Since this is a biblical institution ordained of God, he was the one who ordained it, he blessed it, it's from him. Now we find today, when we had the case that went before the Supreme Court, one of the justices asked a person who was standing up in defense of same-sex marriage, and he asked the person, he said, well, what if then we have four lawyers who want to get married? What about that? Would that be okay? And then the person arguing for same-sex marriage says, well, no, that wouldn't be right because then that would destroy the definition of marriage. Hello? Hello? I thought about this in the context of a senator out in California some years ago. And there was a general who was there being very respectful of this female senator who was sitting there asking questions. And he referred to her in some very polite way, and he referred to her as ma'am or something of that order. And she became indignant. And she says, no, you call me senator. I earned that title. I am a senator. You will call me senator. And he, with more grace than many people, acknowledged, yes, Senator. And I thought, you know what? If I had gone to all the trouble to become elected and become a senator, and I want to be called a senator, well, then now she comes up and she said, well, that's nice. I want to become a senator too. Well, no, you've got to be this in order to be a senator. Well, we just redefined the definition. I am now a senator. And then Louise says, you know what? I think if you're like me, you ought to be a senator. And all of a sudden, we have 100 senators. And what do? When we have everybody is now a senator, the office sudden, the name of the title of a senator, it means what? Nothing. And so it is with the institution of marriage. Redefine it, call it anything you want. Bring your dog in. Call it a marriage. What do you got? So the Supreme Court justice asked that question and made everybody a little upset because he asked such a question. The Supreme Court, the direction they take on this issue is very important. The primary question that sits before the Supreme Court, does the U.S. Constitution, here's the word, require same-sex marriage in every state in the nation? That's the question. Not is it permissible, but is it required is the question. You know, and the ramifications of this are a lot. The drifting. The president's solicitor general, General Ronald Verrill, before the Supreme Court, here's what he said. If the Supreme Court rules that same-sex marriage is a constitutional right, then religious colleges could lose their tax-exempt status for opposing gay marriage. And if we think, oh, no, no, it's all just about a couple getting married. And you say, they couldn't do that. They did it to Bob Jones University over another issue. Because their religious belief didn't fall into the confines of government doctrine. You say, oh, New England Bible College, oh, there they go. And you know what? It's not very many steps from there to the local assembly where you and I are. Why? Because you're a bunch of haters and bigots if you don't agree with this teaching. You say, well, that's not where it's going. Well, let's take a look at where we've drifted to. We have the same-sex lobby is seeking to force businesses to close their shops if they do not agree with the agenda. You say, no, that's not true. Yes, it is true, and we have seen it. There's a photographer in one of the western states that refused to take pictures as their business at a same-sex wedding, and as a result of it, she was put out of business. They closed her down, said, if you won't do that, then you cannot practice business. You have to do that. We have in Massachusetts, and we could go on and on and on this morning and talk about different things, but in Massachusetts, the Catholic Charities had an adoption agency. But when they imposed the same-sex marriage in Massachusetts, they then said now to the Catholic Charities, you have to provide adoption for couples that are of the same gender. And the Catholic charity said, look, we're not going to do it. And they said, well, if you won't do that, then you won't do business. So they stopped altogether. So they effectively stopped them from being able to do anything. Why? Because they opposed something based upon their religious conviction and their conscience. The goal is to get everybody who opposes same-sex marriage out of government, not to be able to get any contracts with government, with the idea of silence all speech in government. That same bakery was fined $131,000 because they would not do the things for same-sex marriage. And as a result of it, a fine for saying no. And so there was this GoFund organization set up, and they had started collecting money for it, and they collected like $109,000 towards helping them to reach that goal, to be able to pay off that fine. And so they had that, but you know what? They got so much opposition for the GoFund group that they shut down the GoFund form. Why? They said, because you guys are promoting hate speech, therefore we cannot any longer collect any money for this bakery. It happens. It happens, and it happened. In our military, you say it doesn't go very far. It goes to the military. It goes to our chaplaincy. There are chaplains today who are trying to fight through the military without violating their conscience and preach the Bible and morality and those kind of things. They're in trouble in the military. And some of them have been tossed out. Why? Because they stood up and said, hey, this is what the Bible says. You can't preach a Bible like that. That's our military. You say it doesn't carry effects to that? It does carry effects to that. And it goes farther. We have Memories Pizza in Indiana, the same thing. Here's a pizza place. They're just doing pizzas. That's all they do. And some reporter comes up and asks them, they say, well, would you guys cater a same-sex wedding, whatever? And the young lady, who is the daughter, they don't cater for weddings. They don't cater anything for anybody. They just sell pizzas. And she says, well, no, I don't think we do. And so it became big news. And they had to shut the place down. They broke windows. All kinds of agitation, aggravation came. And you know, I found out, I went to a couple of meetings. In fact, I was just recently with David Gibbs, who is a constitutional attorney who argued before the Supreme Court, happened to be a Christian man representing Christian institutions. And he said, there are churches that are now being sued. You know why they're being sued? They're being sued because they refuse to allow their facilities to be used for the same-sex purposes. Churches, pastors, educational indoctrination. On it goes. Kevin Cochran, he was a fireman. I say was a fireman. And he spoke about his faith regarding marriage and sexuality. And he was fired. Because he believed the Bible and he stood on those things. Fired because of the stand that he took. First thing we need to do, we need to be aware this stuff is going on. We need to be the advocates for God's institution. And we need to advance the truth. How do we do it? The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 through 16, it says that we're to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. A salt does what? It preserves. Light does what? It shines. It exposes things. And as salt, we should be preserving things. Such as, how do we do that? Pray. Proverbs 21, verse 1, it says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and he turns it whichever way he will. And so we need to pray for those justices. We need to pray for people in authority. We need to pray, and we need to pray persistently. And we need to stand and pray, God, move upon the hearts of those people in leadership. We need to pray for those individuals. And then we need to be light. Light shines. The shines. It proclaims truth. Now the problem with our light in the body of Jesus Christ, and I'm not talking about the whole thing. I'm talking about Bible-believing, God-fearing Christians. The problem is that the lights are dim and our wicks need to be trimmed. If you ever had the old kerosene lamps, you know, some of you are familiar with it and some of you, you're too young. You can't understand what old age is. So there you have those, you know, and they'd be really light up and really bright, you know, but every once in a while, after a while, they get kind of dim, and you'd have to take and you have to clip the tip of the wick, and it'd become bright again. Our wick needs to be trimmed because the body of Christ, the light seems somewhat dim. And why is it dim? Well, because sin has entered in, and wherever sin is in the world, it brings chaos. And with chaos, it brings brokenness and broken people. Are there any broken people in the house of God? Absolutely. The church is filled with people who are broken people. The church is filled with people who struggle and strive with this issue of sin. And because of the issues we deal with, it does tend to handicap sometimes our message. But you know what? We need to reach out to those individuals who are broken. And we need to seek to bring about restoration and healing, as it said in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1 and 2, to reach out to the broken, to those who are in bondage, to bring liberty to those individuals. But if we find ourselves in bondage and we are a work in progress, you see, a good illustration of this was when I was in the Army. I was a work in progress. I was a child of God. I was excited about the things of God. I was a zealot even then. I didn't hold back. I let it out no matter who it was or where they were. I would tell everybody about Jesus Christ. And I wasn't hiding who I was. And I got along with people, but you know, I'd go up and I'd tell them that Christ is the answer. Now, I didn't know much. I really didn't know very much. I didn't know much about the Bible. I knew it was God's word. I knew it's the only way of salvation. I knew the answers it had are right. But there's a lot of things I just didn't know. And my life was as a babe in Christ. And as a babe in Christ, I had all kinds of stuff in my life that shouldn't be there. And then one day, I'm talking to a fella, you know, and I'm telling him about Christ. And I'm telling him, he said, you know what, Vale? I might believe you if you quit smoking. Boy, he just took a dagger and ran it right in my heart. It's all my fault the man's going to hell because I'm smoking a cigarette. Well, not really. But it did become something that he could use. And sometimes we in the body of Christ, we're trying to proclaim truth, but we got these things that we need to deal with as well as everything else. And sometimes they get in the way. So what do we do? Should we lower the standard since we're a work in progress? No, we don't lower God's standard. Did God ever lower his standards? Did God ever say, look, the Ten Commandments are too hard for you guys. I think I'll throw them out and make them 10 suggestions. No, I don't think so. The standards remain the same. He didn't throw them out. And so what should we do? According to Isaiah 62 and verse 10, it says there that we're to raise a standard. Now the standard was a flag. And all the tribes had a flag. And so whenever they blow the trumpet, they were to raise up the standard. And so everybody could see the standard and they would draw to the standard and come to the standard. As I remember, some of you have heard me say the Civil War story that I'd never forgotten. The battle was going poorly and the guy who was a standard bearer was up in the front. And because it was going poorly, the crowd in the back, they said, bring the standard back to the men. And the man who was holding the standard said, no, bring the men up to the standard. And our motto and our strive is, we don't bring the standard back, but we ought to strive to get people to come back to the standard. We need to strive to get back to the standard. We need to struggle to do that. Yes, it is a struggle. And there's not anybody here who can say, I have arrived, I've met the standard. It's a little bit like my house. You come into my house, and on that first floor, it for the most part looks pretty good until Sunday afternoon after the grandkids get done. But it looks pretty clean, pretty straightened up, and that looks all right. But you know what? If you walk down into the cellar, it's dark, it's damp for a reason. I don't want you to see what's in there. It is a mess. It's my responsibility. And part of me says, I want to clean it out. So I start to take this out, but there's something that says, no, no, you don't take that out. And no, you know, it's kind of like there's stuff in our life that ought to get out. The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The Lord knows it, Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9. And for us to say, oh, that doesn't happen. I'm not an adulterer. I'm not a murderer. And Jesus said to that group on the Sermon on the Mount, he looks at them and he says to them in Matthew chapter 5, he says, if you hate somebody in your heart, you're guilty of a murder. No, did he shoot him? No, but in his heart he did. Jesus looks at the heart, and some people say, well, look, I've never been unfaithful and untrue. And Jesus said, have you ever looked upon a woman to lust after in her heart? And he said, you're guilty. And none of us are free. So we need to strive. We need to struggle. We need to try to come up to the truth. To tell where we are, we need to be aware. We need to be the advocates, and we need to advance the things. There is a candidate, believe it or not, a candidate for the highest office in our country. Who said this? A deep-seated cultural code, religious beliefs, and structural basis have to be changed to accommodate for abortion. Simply saying your Bible-believing religious faith and your Christianity needs to be subjugated to the prioritizing of a woman's right to abortion. Abortion is the number one priority. That's more important than faith. That's a little bit like saying those bitter clingers to God, their guns and the Bible. That's a candidate for the United States of America. So what do? We need to assess the situation. We need to make an assessment. Why is this happening? What is the cause for what we see? Well, one thing in particular is complacency. And I'll wrap this up swiftly. So I know your heads have disconnected at 12 o'clock. I know you're gone. But I want you to come back for just a few minutes, would you please? I say that because of the things that I'm saying right now are going to put this institution right here into trouble. Because we become a focal point, and it will be. But to assess the situation, why does it happen? I think you get some insight in 1 Kings chapter 11 and verse 14. There was a complacency that came into the life of King Solomon. King Solomon had been a good king. Now he had his flaws, but it says his heart had turned. When he got old, his heart had turned. It became lax. He became complacent. And 1 Kings chapter 11 and verse 14, and it says, and God stirred up an adversary. Where did his adversary came from? It came from God. God stirred it up, said, I think I need to get your attention. In the book of Acts in chapter 8, verse 3 and verse 4, we find here that the church is there in Jerusalem, that they'd been commissioned. They were to go from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the othermost parts of the world, and they were having a good time. People are being saved. Everything going good, great, grand, and glorious, and they're all having a great time, and God has commissioned them to go, but they're still sitting there having a great time. And then persecution came to the church. And when persecution came to the church, it said, didn't it, the word of God, they were scattered everywhere, and the word of God went forth. And so these things happen to get things out. The story some of you have heard about, there was a certain kind of a fish product that was here in the East Coast. And they wanted it over in the West Coast. And so they would take it and they would ship it all the way around from the East to the West. But when they got over there, it didn't taste the same. It kind of had a stale taste to it. So they said, well, that wasn't work. They tried to put it on ice. Well, that didn't work either. And somebody got the idea, you know what we ought to do? We ought to put the predator in there with those fish. Just a little bit. So they put the predator in with the fish. And you know what? When they got to the other side, the fish were fresh. And it was good. Why? Because they were stirred up. They were moving. They were in action. They weren't dormant. And so it is. We have these things happen for the same reason. What's a correction for us? It starts with me. How do we correct it? It starts with me. That's revival. Somebody said, you want a revival, what you do, you stand there, draw a circle around yourself, and you say, it starts here. It starts here. Revival. That's where it's got to start. The compassion, whatever we do, needs to be done with compassion. The lady who was involved in a Roe v. Wade decision, long story short, she's now a Christian advocating Christ. Why? Somebody had compassion upon her who worked side by side with her, wasn't condemning her, but won her as a friend and presented Christ to her, and she came to know Christ as a Savior. She didn't pound her to death. She presented Christ. What is the real issue? The real issue is pictured right here. It's sin. All of the roots have, we have the same root and the same tree, but you have this fruit. So what is the fruit of sin? Lying, cheating, coveting, murder, adultery, homosexuality, you name every one of them, they all come from the same root. And so what do we find? It all comes from the same place. And the real issue that we have before us that we see, the real issue we need to understand, it is not government, it is not the state, it is not the church, it is not the individual. They can seek to get approval from the government to say, that'll make me feel better. No, they can get the approval from the state, that'll make me feel better. We can force approval of the church, that'll make me feel better. We can get individuals to have to say it's okay, that'll make me feel better. But no, the answer is not a problem with any of those things. The problem is with an individual and God. It's just like every sin. It's a sin between me and God that caused the problem. Therein lies the issue. It is that personal matter between me and God. We live in difficult times. In fact, I just heard from David Gibbs here that 2-3 years ago, there was a case that was brought before the United States Supreme Court, which I wasn't aware of, and the case was about is it constitutional to be able to pray in public in Jesus' name? And what was so amazing to me was the outcome of the court. 5-4. 5 said, yes, you can pray in Jesus' name. And 4 of our current justices said no, because it's distinct and separate. It's the only way. Their desire was to remove Jesus from all public life. It's okay for us to have these beliefs in Jesus and all that stuff within the confines of the four walls here, within the confines of your home, but don't take it out in the public. Jesus should not be seen there. Therein was their idea. The past voices of the culture that stood up are not here. Jerry Falwell, not here. Adrian Rogers, he's not here. James Kennedy is not here. Today, God is looking for voices crying in the wilderness. And will he find them here? The 60s, the goal in the 60s was this, of the gay, lesbian movement, the whole thing. Their goal was this, to gain controlling influence over the media, to gain controlling influence over the politicians, to gain controlling influence in business, to gain controlling influence in education, to gain controlling influence in the churches. They've done a pretty good job. They've got the media, they've got the politicians, they have the businesses, and they have education for the most part. And we say, well, they got the backline, we got the churches. Well, mainline churches have already bought into this. Some other churches said we'll be neutral. Then we come to the evangelical churches, churches like this. And many of the evangelical Bible-believing churches have chosen to be silent. Net effect, 80% of the churches are on board. 80%. That leaves only 20%. And their goal is this, submit, be silent, or we will destroy you. Does that sound familiar? Submit, be silent, or we'll destroy you. It should sound familiar because it comes from the same source. It's a spiritual warfare that we're in, Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12. The same origin came from the same satanic forces, and therefore it's the same satanic ideology. We will make you submit to us, we will make you silent, and if you will not be silent, we will destroy you. That's what we'll do. In the book of Ezekiel in chapter 22 and verse 30, God said he's looking for people who will stand in the gap and make up the hedge for the people. Read the reference on your own. He says, I'm looking for somebody who would stand in the gap. That's where it's all flowing through. To make up the hedge. Why? For the people. For the people. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 8, the Lord says, who will go for us? Who will go for us? And the answer was, here am I. Send me. When it came to Samuel, and the Lord spoke, and he says, here am I, send me. When you and I stand in the gap, we need to have the right perspective and realize in standing up for Jesus, you and I are standing in the gap for people, not against people. For the rescue of people, for the help of people, for the benefit of people, for the cause, we need to stand. We're no better than anybody else. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 through 11 tells us that we have all kinds of sinners, which we are. And which we have been, but we've been redeemed and we've been sanctified. So, after going to this conference and hearing this speaking, this one after another, and I'm sitting here saying, I don't want to hear this, I don't want to hear this, this is not good, this is depressing, this is discouraging, this is awful. You go to a conference, you want to go away picked up, lifted up, and say, whew. No. But he ended with this. He ended the conference with this, and this, I thought, this is it. This really is the answer in the book of Acts in chapter 4. Nothing new under the sun. It came to them. It came to us. It says in Acts chapter 4, verse 29, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and to grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word. What do we need? We need to become aware. We need to be advocates. We need to advance. We need to make an assessment. And then we need to be bold. Bold. You've got nothing to be ashamed of. You've got nothing to back down for. And in our boldness, will we pay a price? Yes, others have, and you will too, and we will as well. Whether we pay it today, tomorrow, or the days to come, we'll pay a price. But the question is, will we stand? That's really individual. Will you stand? with Jesus. I thought about this song. I would even sing it, but I know better. It's this. It only takes a spark to get a fire going, and soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love once you've experienced it. You want to sing. It's fresh like spring. You want to pass it on. I wish for you and all my friends this happiness that I've found. You can depend on Him. It matters not where you're bound. I'll shout it from the mountaintop. I want my world to know the Lord of love has come to me. I want to pass it on. I read this. I probably dropped it. True to my case. Where is it? What did I do? Did you see me kick something around here, a little booklet or something? I probably did. I have to tell it to you. In World War II, in invasion of Normandy, there were three officers. And they had drifted farther from where they were supposed to land. And then when they did land, they landed in the wrong spot. And there they were in a hole. And there in that hole, they had to make a decision. What do we do now? And they made an impromptu decision under difficult circumstances. And they said, well, the war starts here. And they started. When the Apostle Paul came to the crossroads with Jesus, he looked at his life past and may have figured it was all a waste. He'd ruined it all. And then he had to look to the future and say, now what am I going to do? I may have to confront those very people whose lives I have destroyed. And he concluded by saying, Lord, what would you have me to do? And then you and I, we look at our life and we say, but I have messed things up. I have really fouled up my life. It is in catastrophe, and everything's all wrong. I've got this wrong. My sin is besetting me. This is all, and all that. And you know what? He said, it starts here. It starts now, and it starts today. This is a day. I don't care what our past has been. It's the present that we press forward. If we do not, we will reap what we sow. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I know that this is kind of a hard message. It's not the kind that we come up and we'll walk out of here saying, "Woo, boy, that's really good. I feel so excited." But Lord, it is the day that we live. The need of the hour. And Father, I'd ask that you'd grant to each one of us the grace to stand in the hour, in the place that you've placed us, wherever that might be. And Lord, there's many of us here who are struggling with things and brokenness, and not here to condemn and throw rocks, but Lord, help us by your grace to, wherever it is, to start anew. Start today. And if there's somebody here who's never come to know you, then Lord, I'd ask that you'd move on their heart, that they realize you're the one that gives us a passion for life, the love of life and eternity. Lord God, have your way in our hearts this day, in Jesus' name. Amen.